What's going on, y'all? Thanks for checking in to Khaliis Take. You know what to do. Hit that like, subscribe button. Also hit that notification bell just so you can get the newest and the bonus content first. But hey, let's just go ahead and jump right in. You know, a lot of people are going to say Patrick Beverley's comments a day ago or so was out of bounds in regards to, you know, what he said about Chris Paul. And in regards to what he said about, not what he said about Paul George, but mentioning Paul George in speaking about Chris Paul and how overrated Chris Paul is in so many words. And some people are going to take it that way. Some people are not. And I definitely understand either way if you go with that. But when you look at it from a standpoint of what Pat Bev was saying, he said a lot of good things. You know, he said, you know, Pat Beverley was almost talking as if he was still playing for the Clippers, because the first thing he came out with was basically, you know, in so many words, if Kawhi Leonard was healthy, they go to the finals. And Stephen A. Smith co-signed it. He basically said the same thing. He said he agreed with that because, I mean, if Kawhi was healthy, they would have been in the finals. There would have never been no Phoenix Suns in the NBA finals or even remotely close to there, because Pat Bev is right. Nobody's scared of the Phoenix Suns. DeAndre Ayton is not the big man that a lot of people think that he is. He's got a lot of talent, a lot of upside. I actually like DeAndre Ayton myself, but he's not a dominant big man, you know, to a point where he could just take over a game and just, you know, impose his will on the other team. Because think about it, in the Dallas Mavericks series they just played and got, you know, embarrassed in, he's being guarded by a guy named Dwight Powell. Dwight Powell should not be able to stop DeAndre Ayton at any point, any game, anytime, anywhere, or in any arena that he decides to play in. Dwight Powell is just an energy guy trying to, you know, get some minutes, trying to really, you know, establish himself as a player in the league, because a lot of people don't even know who he is. And he's just, you know, basically a role player playing for Dallas, and, you know, really just, like I said, just trying to establish himself and everything. But main point of emphasis, he should not be able to stop somebody like DeAndre Ayton, who is supposed to be more of a force and more of a valuable player for his team than what Dwight Powell is for his team. So you definitely didn't get what you needed out of, you know, Ayton in that way. But even still, you know, the way they went out was bad and everything like that. And, you know, the moral of the story is, when you think about it, Chris Paul, to me, I always looked at him as an overrated player. I don't know too much about Devin Booker in that way, simply because, I mean, Devin Booker's been playing the league for a few years now. But, you know, Devin Booker has time to improve. Chris Paul doesn't. He is who he is at this point in his career. He's had a bunch of 2-0 leads and blown them. And, you know, he doesn't get criticized for it. And, you know, Pat Bev made a good point about the team, Chris Paul and everybody. You know, mainly Chris Paul is who he was going at, because, you know, he's not a fan of Chris Paul at all. We both know that. Everybody knows that. But at the same time, he made a point, because when you speak about Chris Paul, he gets a pass on a lot of things, maybe because he's the president or something like that, or works for the board, NBA board or something like that, what he does. And he's so well liked by so-called a lot of people. But I mean, I personally know a lot of people who don't like him myself. But I mean, that's just me. But I personally am not a fan of his myself. But at the same time, you know, he gets a pass on blowing all these 2-0 leads. And, you know, they sit around and talking about somebody like Paul George, Playoff P, and how he's, you know, they talked about Playoff P when he was having his struggles, like he was a garbage player, like he never was any good. But you have a player like Chris Paul who gets all this praise, and, you know, he'd been to one NBA finals because everybody in the NBA world was hurt, basically. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, now they get blown out by a team with one guy, basically Luka Doncic, and a bunch of role players that nobody knows who they are. Jason Kidd got them playing very well, but nobody knows the role players on Dallas like that. And he's basically supposed to get a pass. And Patrick Beverley was saying, no, if you're going to criticize somebody like Paul George and call him way off P, playoff P, and when he was going through his mental issues and all that stuff, you should do the exact same thing to somebody like Chris Paul. And that's why I see it. You know, I'm definitely with Patrick Beverley on that. Now, I will say Pat Bev, you know, he speaks from his heart. He wears a shoulder on his sleeve. You know, he definitely, you know, gives you his opinion, whether you like him or not. He's definitely one of those people I would say you'll never hear somebody say Patrick Beverley is all right. You'll always hear somebody say either they like him or they can't stand him. You know, that's just the way Patrick Beverley is. And that's the way he's wired. And that's just, you know, that's just what comes with being him. And I definitely respect that about him, though, because, you know what I'm saying? He's definitely going to give you the real of what the situation is. And, you know, to be quite honest, he didn't literally say that, you know, Chris Paul was overrated or anything. But in so many words, I feel like he did, because, you know, Chris Paul to me has always been overrated. He's always been looked at in this light in a certain spectrum where, you know, he's this great player, and he is a great player. And I don't want that to get confused. He is a great player. And I don't agree with Patrick Beverley's assessment on he couldn't defend, because, I mean, he could defend a little bit. He can't defend at a level like maybe Patrick Beverley can or something like that. That's what Patrick Beverley got drafted to the league for, so he can't defend on that level. But I mean, he has led the league in steals like 5-6 years in a row. He's been on an all defensive team before, I believe. So I mean, he has some type of defense to lead the league in steals. You got some type of defense. It may not be the best defense, but it's called defense. If you steal the ball, it's defense. So I mean, I can't say he can't defend a little bit, or maybe now he can't defend, you know, quite at that level. But he was able to defend a little bit better back in his younger days. But I mean, he is a Hall of Famer. You got to give him respect for that. But at the same time, Patrick Beverley did make some good points, and I definitely like the point specifically that he pointed out about when he put Paul George in it. And he even said Paul George said nobody's scared of the Phoenix Suns. So that's the reason why everybody knew if Kawhi Leonard was healthy, that was the Clippers championship to win, because they definitely would have beat Giannis and the Bucks. Because I just don't, you know, Giannis is a great player, but to me, if you can't shoot a jump shot, at some point you're going to get exposed, because every great player you've ever seen that really dominated like that has always had a jump shot. Or, I mean, unless it's Shaquille O'Neal, because Shaquille O'Neal was the most dominant, strongest, you know, big man we ever seen. But Shaq also had Kobe, and he also had D Wade, who can shoot the ball a little bit better than he can. So they made up for what he couldn't do. But Giannis, you know what I'm saying, like him, he's a great player and all that, but without that jumper being fluent, you know what I'm saying, that's going to hurt his chances of winning probably multiple championships. Maybe he will, but maybe he won't. But this is my point. The Clippers definitely would have been to a finals if it wasn't for Kawhi getting hurt. And Patrick Beverley made a good, you know, analysis on that part. And, you know, if, like I said, if you're going to call out somebody like Paul George when every time he messes up or anytime he makes a mistake and he's no good and he's fragile and he's playoff and way off P and all those things, you know, you got to sit there and be fair and do the same thing with Chris Paul. Don't give Chris Paul a pass because, you know, he worked for the NBA board or whatever. Nobody gives a damn about that. You lost convincingly, horribly. It was the most embarrassing game seven playoff loss I've ever seen in my life, and I think a lot of people can agree to that. That's the reason why this story doesn't seem to end, and it's going to probably go all the way into the summer, and you know, it's going to follow them until they find a way to come back and win a championship, and if they're able to do that. But it's going to be tougher because Chris Paul is going to be a year older, and then on top of that, you know, Devin Booker, who knows where his mental is at. You see what I'm saying? He's pretty much is where he is. And like Patrick Beverley said, look, all the teams are going to be healthy next year, the Clippers being one of them. With Kawhi Leonard coming back, it's going to be tough to knock off a team like that with all the talent that they have. I mean, it just is. And then, like I said, they might even be without DeAndre Ayton, you know, and going the next season, simply because, you know, they might trade him away because of the rift in him and Monty Williams had, you know, on the sideline. And Monty Williams saying he basically quit on the team. So, you know, they even might be without DeAndre Ayton going forward. So, I mean, it's like the Suns team might be completely different and Chris Paul be a year older. So it's like, I don't know. I mean, when you look at their team, I don't know where they're going to go, but I don't think up is it from here. And like I said, with a healthy Clippers, I don't really care about nobody else's chances in the NBA. I mean, unless somebody forms a big four or a big three or something like that, I don't think nobody's beating the Clippers in a 7-game series going into next season. And I definitely think the Clippers definitely have the upper hand. But hey, that's my take on everything. Leave any comments in the comment section as always. And hey, Khaliis out.